I do not have any disclosures. TBI and stroke constitute more than 0.5% of the neurosurgical workload, particularly in third world countries, and it incurs a high cost besides morbidity and mortality associated with it. And a common neurosurgical procedure for both the conditions is decompressive craniotomy. Recently, the Brain Trauma Foundations upgrade their recommendations on decompressive craniotomy and traumatic brain injury. Though the evidence is not strong, but decompressive craniotomy, particularly secondary DC performed for late refractory intracranial pressure, is recommended. However, it is not recommended as an early procedure, and a large craniotomy should be done. Both primary as well as secondary DC are effective for reduction of intracranial pressure and duration of ICU. However, outcome as far as functional outcome is concerned is unsure. It is already well known that decompressive craniotomy reduces the mortality by half in patients with malignant cerebral infections. Then why do we need an alternative to decompressive craniotomy? We all know that DC, though it sounds very simple as removing the lid of a pressure cooker, with complications immediately like hemorrhagic expansion of underlying hematoma, infection which can be as bad as abscess, and later subdural hygromas and hydrocephalus, and much later sunken flap syndrome. This is not enough. If you have opened the lid of the cooker, you have to place it back. And the storage complications like storing in anterior abdominal wall can also have complications. When the bone flap is placed back on the head, there can be hemorrhages again with seizures, with infections, and sometimes the bone flap does not sit well, giving rise to poor cosmetic outcome. So what basically DC does, it expands the volume of the skull so that the pressure can reduce. So how we can reduce the pressure without actually removing the bone flap? So one procedure is called hinge craniotomy or expansile craniotomy, in which you remove the bone flap, however you place it back loosely without tying to the native skull so that the volume remains expanded and there is no need of second surgery, that is cranioplasty. One can also reduce the intracranial volume by releasing the CSF. Though CSF does not constitute major intracranial volume, the pressure volume curve shows that even smaller reduction in volume can significantly reduce the intracranial pressure. So what is a hinge craniotomy? Hinge craniotomy is basically craniotomy where the bone flap is not fixed to the skull but hinged at only one plane so that it remains as an open door, and when the brain swelling subsides, the door closes on its own. So theoretically, hinge craniotomy has benefits like it can control at least moderate cerebral edema. It definitely eliminates the need of subsequent cranioplasty, and it reduces the axonal stretching which can happen after decompressive craniotomy, and theoretically have fewer complications. This is from Global Neurotrauma, in which we are also part of. We did a scoping review and we found that nearly 283 patients have undergone this hinge craniotomy, mostly for traumatic brain injury when there was acute subdural hematoma beneath, and as well for stroke, particularly ischemic stroke. So what we do at our place, we do not hinge the bone. Instead, we expand the bone flap by cutting it into three pieces and tying them loosely with each other as well as to the native skull. And we have found that the intracranial volume expansion attained by hinge craniotomy or expansile craniotomy is as good as by decompressive craniotomy. It also reduces the intracranial pressure. This is a case study which shows that there was a significant reduction of intracranial pressure and improvement in cerebral perfusion pressure following expansile craniotomy. Though there is a theoretical possibility that ICP may not reduce significantly or may rise paradoxically after expansile craniotomy, however, such instances are very fewer, and in our review, we found only 3% of such cases. Hinge craniotomy is definitely associated with better outcome at par with decompressive craniotomy, and in traumatic brain injury it has been found there was no difference in terms of mortality. However, patients who underwent decompressive craniotomy had poorer outcome. Same thing was observed in cases of stroke, that hinge craniotomy was associated with better long-term functional outcome. In our studies also, though apparently it appears that hinge craniotomy is better, however, there was no statistical significant difference between outcome as compared to decompressive craniotomy. We have criticized decompressive craniotomy a lot in terms of complication, but whether hinge craniotomy is safe? It appears that complications are at par with decompressive craniotomy. However, the delayed complications like sunken flap syndrome, hydrocephalus requiring VP shunt, does not exist in patients who undergo expansile craniotomy. So, should one switch over to hinge craniotomy from decompressive? No, not yet. However, hinge craniotomy can be considered as an alternative, but not to all DC, but definitely to primary DC, not to secondary DC. And we need further studies to know which are the most appropriate and most effective technique of hinge craniotomy, and a multinational trial is required. So verdict, hinge craniotomy has potential role in surgical management, yielding at par cerebral decompression with reduction of ICP, and it reduces cost by mitigating the second surgery, that is cranioplasty. Hinge craniotomy probably offers an intermediate intervention between refractory medical treatment and traditional decompressive craniotomy. Coming to the second procedure, that is CSF drainage, which is not a new procedure, but it was only about 2 or 3 decades back that CSF drainage for reduction of intracranial pressure for traumatic brain injury was described. An external ventricular drainage is often placed only for monitoring of intracranial pressure, but even small CSF drainage can lower ICP significantly. And besides lowering intracranial pressure, it also clears the hemorrhage from the ventricle. It decreases the cerebral metabolic rate for oxygen demand. It improves the perfusion. EVD insertion in patients with TBI with small ventricle can be challenging, and the coronal suture may not be palpable because of scalp swelling or subgaleal hematoma in head injury patients. So just go 10 cm from the nasion, 10 to 11 cm and 3 to 5 cm depending on the midline shift, and directing toward the canthus, one should be able to hit the ventricle. I must emphasize that though it sounds simple, but not many people practice freehand EVD insertion, and it is also equally important to learn EVD insertion in small ventricle as it is important to learn aneurysm clipping or posterior circulation. So whether it should be drained continuously or intermittently, continuous has definite advantage that lowers the ICP overall and it lowers the biochemical markers of injury. However, it results in ventricular collapse and blockage of EVD. Intermittent is mainly used for monitoring rather than duration, and the amount of CSF which is drained through intermittent is prefixed. So in most parts of America, Australia and Europe, it is used as first tier treatment. In United Kingdom, it is second, and in some places even third tier treatment. Though EVD is not an alternative to DC, it is often used before DC. But there is one study which compared DC with EVD, and they found that ICP control was equal with both, and the need of a second procedure, that is EVD in case of DC and vice versa, was also similar. So the need of DC after EVD has been found like nil in some studies to up to 50% in some other studies as well. So EVD decreases in hospital mortality, 28-day mortality, and decreases the proportion of patients with unfavorable outcome at 6 months, and it improves by 2 to 2.8 times. EVD is also associated with complications whether you put it early or late. Main worry is infection. However, with a standard protocol, infection rates can be reduced. So surgery is fashion. It comes and goes. However, there are methodology to assess new surgery called ideal methodology. So currently, both the procedures can be considered between exploration and assessment stage, and we require more data before we can replace one of them. As I told you, surgery is fashion and it varies from nation to nation. But the current pandemic has shown us that for all nation, there is one fashion. And I wish all of you stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you.